Hi everyone, and welcome back to The Thing About Parenting. I just want to remind you that the information in this podcast is not meant to replace or substitute for that of licensed professionals. If you, your children, or your family are experiencing a crisis beyond the scope of what we share in this podcast, please seek professional help. So in my last podcast, the intro podcast, I talked about meeting your children where they are and growing from there. And in order for us to meet our children where they are, we need to be able to meet ourselves where we are and grow from there. Parenting is one of the greatest experiences in life, and it's also one of the most complicated, complex, and confusing ones as well. None of which is made easier by the plethora of advice that is out there on the best practices for raising children. Part of the problem with some of the advice out there is that much of it is assumed to work for all parents, children, and families, rather than considering for each individual child, the parents, the family, and the specific needs they have. It's also promoted as though anyone can do it and be successful, which fails to consider for many aspects and conditions, including parenting skills, experience, resources, and abilities. Many of us will try what is offered by the current experts and not see the results they promised. Far more of us will see or hear about what others have done or recommended and become disappointed when the outcome isn't the same for us. And a large number of us will see families who seem to have it all together, the ideal or perfect children and family life that we always hoped or expected it would be for us. What we may be failing to recognize, however, is that we are not those people and their children are not our children. There is nothing wrong with wanting a healthy and happy family, and there's nothing wrong with trying what others suggest either. In fact, flexibility is essential in parenting. But when we pin our hopes on the outcomes others have achieved or expect that our children will fall in line with the methods we experiment with, and it doesn't happen the way we wanted, we will surely face disappointment and frustration in ourselves and in our children. One of the best ways to increase the odds of that happy and healthy family is, just as I mentioned earlier, to be flexible. And the key to making this happen is in meeting yourself where you are and growing from there. Have you ever wondered why something keeps happening to you over and over and over again? Do you ever feel like you can't catch a break in life? Have you ever seen someone who seems to have it all and you're wondering how it is they get to have it when you worked so hard or maybe even harder? Have you ever asked where your child gets the idea that they're so entitled to things or where they get the idea that they don't have to follow the rules? Or maybe you sense that people don't respect you, your position at work, as a parent, for who you are and what you've done. Maybe you say to yourself that no one understands you or can meet you at your level. Or perhaps you see your children as having no regard for you as a parent, that they're nothing like you were as a child, and that they should be doing as you say and following the rules. Do either of these scenarios listed seem to be coming from a more empowered place and the other from a weaker or disempowered place? You might be surprised to learn that both of them are actually coming from a disempowered place. Why? Because one, we're comparing ourselves to others, and two, our expectations. We cannot meet ourselves where we are if we're comparing ourselves to others, good or bad. If we're trying to show up the way others tell us to or how we think others would view us, or if we're making our way through life based on how we see it happening for others. Because when we do so, we're at effect rather than at cause, and we are surrendering our power by giving our responsibility for our own lives over to others and circumstance. We all have a perception of who we are, good or bad, and that's just what it is, a perception. When you feel strong in who you are and you're standing your ground, or you're hurt, angry, or otherwise upset with someone or something, if you are blaming, shaming, or holding anyone or anything else responsible for where you are right now, you will not be able to see, hear, or connect to what you need to make change and not only have happy, healthy relationships with others, but to have a happy, healthy relationship with yourself. We need to be willing to open our hearts and our minds to how others perceive us if we want to have happy and healthy and empowered relationships. This is not that we are responsible for how they perceive our words or actions, but to be mindful of how our words or actions can affect them. Why? Because when we are so sure of who we think we are and we think we're better than others, we miss the opportunity for learning and growth. And when we're not sure of who we think we are or we think we're less than others, we tend to be in victim mode. Either way, we are at effect rather than at cause, and we are surrendering our power by giving our responsibility for our lives over to others and circumstance. I know some of you are questioning me on this, but hear me out here. It's not that having a strong sense of self, having self-confidence, or seeing yourself in a positive light is problematic. That can be very healthy and empowering. But just like a lack of sense of self, lacking self-confidence, and seeing yourself in a negative light keeps us stuck where we are, so too does an unhealthy, though seemingly positive, sense of ourselves. Allow me to show you an example and see if you can visualize what I mean. Have you ever met or known someone who just exudes self-confidence and seems so successful, whether at work, in relationships, with their family, but on closer inspection has trouble keeping jobs for long, or their company has a higher turnover, or you hear their employees complaining, or maybe they've had multiple short-term relationships, they can't seem to find the one, or they complain that there are no good people out there. Or perhaps their family seems perfect on the outside, but behind closed doors there's dysfunction and disconnect. Yes, I know many families will have dysfunction and disconnect. And what I'm talking about here is when a person has an unhealthy perception of what is going on, and in doing so, they fail to open up, see, hear, and connect in ways that can heal and empower their relationships with themselves and with others. So how do we meet ourselves where we are and grow from there? One, and this is an essential first step, is having an awareness of our reality. How we show up, what we see as being a problem, how we view a situation and the people involved, and the meaning we make of it all. Second is, in the awareness, being at cause and taking responsibility for our role in the situation, for how we interpreted it, the meaning we made of it, and if we are holding someone or something responsible for it. Third is believing that change is possible. Not that we can change the situation or the other people involved, but rather that we can make a change in ourselves, the meaning we make of the people in the situation, and knowing that we are the ones with the choice to do differently. Fourth is having grace and space for ourselves. Even when we know right from wrong or that we could have handled something differently, the fact is we didn't. We're still human, and in that moment, we function impulsively when we feel threatened. Our instant response to something has to do with fight, flight, and freeze, and in most cases goes directly to our ego after that. The reaction we have to whatever happens is based on the tools we had at the time. And many of us were never really taught or had modeled to us more effective and healthy ways to deal with upsets. Fifth is in having grace and space for others. Even if we think they should know right from wrong or that they should have handled it differently, the fact is they didn't. They too are still human and in that moment function impulsively when they feel threatened. Their instant response to something also has to do with fight, flight, and freeze, and in most cases goes directly to their ego after that. The reaction they may have is based on the tools they had at the time, and they too maybe never really had taught to them or modeled to them more effective and healthy ways of dealing with upsets. So how does this all tie into parenting? Well, starting with point one, the essential first step is having an awareness of our reality. How are we showing up? What are we seeing as a problem? How are we viewing the situation and the people involved? And what meaning are we making of it? When a situation comes up, how are we interpreting it? What meaning are we making of it, of ourselves, and of our children? Second is the awareness of being at cause and taking responsibility for our role in the relationship, for how we interpret it and the meaning we make of it, and if we are holding our children or something else responsible for it. Are we seeing our part in this, or are we blaming our children or something else for what is happening? Third is in believing that change is possible. Not that we can change our children or the situation, but that we can make a change in ourselves, the meaning we make of the people involved, the meaning of the situation, and knowing that we are the ones with the choice to do differently. Even if, or perhaps even more so, if there's something that keeps happening, there's likely a pattern that needs to be identified. Take a look at the situation and the circumstances in and around what might be, and see what might be needed to change, or what you can do differently next time. With our children, we need to be their role models. So for example, if we want a certain from our behavior from our children to change, we need to model and show them how to do it. So let's say your child throws a fit when they don't get their way. Think about how you handle similar situations. Be honest. Are you calm, thoughtful, and considerate when things didn't go as you planned? Or do you react in anger and argue with another person or try to get your way? Children are mega sponges. They absorb everything they see and hear you do. And if you tell them to behave one way, but you act in another way, it not only undermines their trust in your word, but their trust in you. And children are far more likely to do as you do rather than as you say. Fourth is having grace and space for ourselves. Even when we know right from wrong or that we could have handled something differently, the fact is we didn't. And again, in that moment, we're doing fight, flight, and freeze, and then it goes directly to our ego. The reaction to whatever we have is happening is based on the tools we had at that time. And again, you know, when we were kids, we may not have had our parents modeling the best skills to use in situations like that. With our children, we may, at times, have a more difficult time refraining from reacting in the moment to our children if they're whining, if their cries are shrill and loud, if they've been asking the same question over and over and over again, if we're already tired, or because we simply cannot reason with anyone who is emotionally upset. The key, and tying it back to points 1 and 2, is gaining the awareness of our reaction and taking responsibility for it. When we reacted, and we take that responsibility for our action, we can give ourselves the grace and space for having done so, and more importantly, pay attention to what we can do differently next time. Fifth is having grace and space for others and our children. Even though we think they should know right from wrong or that they should have handled it differently, the fact is they didn't. They, just like us, are humans in a tinier version and are more prone to that fight, flight, and freeze reaction because the part of their brain that can reason and make sense and think things through isn't developed until their mid-20s. So they are far more reactive. And the reaction they have is based on the tools at that time, which basically kind of go out the window for children. With our children, we need to extend grace and space to them by remembering that they lack the experience, skills, capacities, and maturity to handle their feelings and emotions. It's also important to reflect on how we have handled our feelings and emotions when we've been upset or disappointed, and how we may have modeled how we handled those times, remembering that our children are far more likely to do what we do than what we say. So now that we know how to meet ourselves where we are and to grow from there, the next podcast will be on helping our children and ourselves meet our children where they are and growing from there. Just a reminder, the information in this podcast is not meant to replace or substitute that of licensed professionals. If you, your family, or your children are experiencing crisis beyond the scope of what we cover here, please seek professional help. So until next time, bye.